There's a lot of fan crossover between Star Trek and author Sir Arthur Conan Doyle's most famous creation, Sherlock Holmes. In fact, the world's first consulting detective makes a few cameos in our favorite science fiction series. Robert Steck and Monica Schmidt are Star Trek fans who also happen to belong to the Baker Street Irregulars, America's preeminent Sherlock Holmes society. They joined me to talk about Sherlock and Star Trek. I'm T-Rick Jones, and this is your Daily Star Trek News. What is the Baker Street Irregulars? Can you guys explain it to us?
Bob, do you want to take this one or shall I?
Go ahead, Monica.
Okay. So the Baker Street Irregulars is a literary society that was founded in the 1930s, so 1934, kind of as an opportunity to basically for people to gather as who are fans of Sherlock Holmes and to celebrate Sherlock Holmes's birthday. It started out kind of as a private club of author and editor Christopher Morley, who was a publisher at Doubleday back in the day, and also I think he wrote the book that the Oscar-winning film Kitty Foyle from 1940 was based on. So, I mean, not exactly a slouch in any imaginable form. But essentially, it was like an offshoot of one of his other clubs called the 3 Hours for Lunch Club. Essentially, an opportunity for people to gather together, drink, eat, talk, BS about a bunch of stuff. And the topic happened to be Sherlock Holmes. They had so much fun that they decided to kind of quasi-formalize it into the Baker Street Irregulars. And then it became like an invitation only and also men only organization for many, many years. Over the last 90 years, the society has evolved, has grown exponentially, and includes actually broke the gender barrier. Oh gosh, 33 years ago now, I think.
Yeah.
Yeah. So I'm a Bob's been a member for a lot longer than I have, and involved in the community a lot longer than I have. But definitely very, very proud tradition. As Bob mentioned, Isaac Asimov was a member, but we also had FDR and Truman as honorary members. Neil Gaiman is currently a member. I mean, there's notable notables, and then there's like people like me. I'm the therapist in Iowa. Like I'm not no notable or famous or anything, but I do know a whole heck of a lot about Sherlock Holmes. So.
Yeah, and how long have you been a member?
Since 2019, so this was my 5 year anniversary this past year.
Congratulations, happy
Thank you.
anniversary.
Thank
And
you.
for those who don't know, new BSI members are given an investiture,
Ah,
usually something from the canon. And Monica, yours is?
oh, I am Julia Stoner. I am the dead body from the Speckled Band.
So, which is a very, very popular, very excellent Sherlock Holmes story. If you haven't read it, if you haven't read the canon, that actually might be a good place to start. And Bob, what's your investiture?
I am the mysterious scientist, which is a reference to Professor Presberry in the story of the creeping man. Another psychologist had already had the investiture of Professor Presberry, and I believe, because we were both psychologists, it was appropriate for me to be the mysterious scientist. I have a background. I started off school in science and engineering school before I became a psychology major, so I'm very happy to be the mysterious scientist.
We're here to talk about Sherlock Holmes and Star Trek. So, the first reference to Sherlock Holmes that I can think of is in Star Trek VI when Spock says,
"An ancestor of mine maintained that if you eliminate the impossible, whatever remains, however improbable, must be the truth."
Could either mean that he's an ancestor of Sherlock Holmes or an ancestor of Arthur Conan Doyle, who wrote the Sherlock Holmes stories.
Or something else, as we may
Or
discover.
something else, which we'll talk about in a moment. I do want to point out that Nicholas Meyer, who all everybody watching this will know, rejuvenated Star Trek with Star Trek II and directed Star Trek IV and directed Star Trek VI. Nicholas Meyer is also a BSI.
Yes, he is.
The Baker Street Irregulars as well. So do you guys know who his investiture is? I don't know.
Oh, he's a fine Morocco case. He's class of 2004.
Bob, you wrote a little story recently called An Ancestor of Mine that is takes that idea of Spock's ancestor being involved in Sherlockian canon. And you wrote a story about that. You want to give us sort of the elevator pitch without spoiling too much?
Well, I will tell you the genesis of the story. This was written because it was something I wanted to read. I am not a writer of fiction. I love reading fiction, and I've written articles, psychology journal articles, that type of writing, but I hesitate to put electrons to screen in doing anything fictional. Yet there is a convention called 221 BCon, which is held in Atlanta each year. And I had been in Arizona for 8 or 10 years, and very traditional, what are called Scion societies, local Sherlock Holmes groups that get together. And I came back to the East Coast and decided to go to this convention of Sherlockians. I said, oh, this is great. Having no idea that this was really more organized around Benedict Cumberbatch's Sherlock. Mm-hmm. I mean, yes, there were references to other Sherlock Holmes, but this was really about Benedict Cumberbatch. And I got there and was very surprised to find myself among about 1,100 mostly young women were enamored with the new TV show Sherlock. But I did my piece. I talked about Conan Doyle and spiritualism. And then I went to another presentation. A friend of mine was on, Lindsay Fay, who's a wonderful author herself.
Oh, she's fantastic.
Yeah, she was on this panel called From Baker Street to the Holodeck, Sherlock Holmes and Science Fiction. And they discussed, some of what, we might discuss here today. But at the end, there was time for some questions. And I asked the panel a question. I said, I've had this idea for crossover fiction that seems so obvious that someone must have written this already. I mean, there is such a close connection between Sherlock Holmes and Mr. Spock. Can anyone on the panel please tell me, if I summarize, this idea of mine, someone must have written it. Can I find it somewhere? Because I just want to read it. And I said, she said, what's your idea? And I said, well, we know that the Enterprise can go back in time. It's done that on several occasions, various ways, but it can go back in time. Mm-hmm. We know that Spock goes through Ponfar every 7 years. He has to mate or he could possibly die. We suppose the Enterprise goes back in time. Spock is separated from the ship for some reason. We don't know why. And he lands in Victorian England. And he seems to be abandoned by the Enterprise because he waits days, then weeks, and then months, and he is not being rescued. And yet he has to survive on Earth in Victorian England. But he goes through Ponfar. And, if he lands in roughly 1846 and meets an Earth woman, can it not be possible that Spock becomes the father of Mycroft and Sherlock Holmes? At that point, I thought it was obvious. To me, this, the characters are so close together. How could someone not think about this? Lindsay literally jumps up from her chair and shouts out, oh my God, of course, it must be true. It explains so much. And the physiological similarities, the personality characteristics, how they feel about logic and emotion, it's all so obvious. And pretty soon the entire room behind me is saying, "Yes, of course, it must be true. You must write that up. You have to." I'm going, I can't write fiction. I don't know how to write fiction."
Yeah.
The next day, I go to a hospitality suite, and someone says, "Are you the Bob that was on that spirituality panel with about Doyle?" I said, "Yes." And then she says, "Oh my God, this is the famous Bob who posits that Spock was the father of Sherlock Holmes. Famous Bob." You can actually Google hashtag famous Bob. Now, I'm not the only one, but if you hashtag famous Bob and Tumblr, you will see that I had like 700 followers on Tumblr who were saying, "We want to read this story. We want to read this story." And I'm going,
We'll just say Bob's reputation traveled very quickly as being the guy who came up with the appropriate explanation to explain what Nicholas Meyer wrote. Nick kind of refuses to clarify his statement because we've nudged him and asked him. Nick is a University of Iowa alum. And from where I currently sit, I'm practically spitting distance from University of Iowa. And
Now
my,
I'm looking
yeah,
for
yep.
I made a comment here. I wrote it down because on Facebook, Nick, I had given him a copy a
Yeah.
year ago at the BSI dinner, and I jokingly said to him, "Once I get 50 readers, I'll contact you again because I want you to be the director of the film version." But he did read it and he commented on
Oh,
Facebook.
so he, oh,
And
I didn't
he
see
said
that.
he gave me a capitalized Bravo, exclamation point, exclamation point, that he had read it. So I'm very happy with that.
Wow.
He was one of the reasons I got into Sherlock Holmes. I mean, I had read the stories when I was younger, but it was his 7% solution as a psychologist and a Sherlockian to pair Sherlock Holmes with Sigmund Freud was perfect as far as I was concerned.
Yeah.
So very, very happy for the Bravo from Nick.
It's a great story.
Oh,
It's
thanks.
written a little bit like Dracula or something, where it's these diary entries by various characters and log entries by Spock.
Right.
Why did you choose
Essentially,
it
I mean,
that way?
it starts off as a traditional Sherlock Holmes story, in which Holmes is very close, to cornering Moriarty, and his brother Mycroft comes to him and says, "Sherlock, we are being blackmailed by Moriarty, and what he stole from me, if it gets out, will change the world and will, destroy us." So he is very worried. And Holmes says, "What are you talking about? What kind of blackmail?" And Mycroft says, "Strictly speaking, our father was not human."
Yeah.
And of course, Holmes recoils at this idea and thinks Mycroft has brain fever. And he's, asking Watson, what can you do about this?" But then he does have copies of the originals that Moriarty has stolen, and they are, as you say, first we read about Spock's how he accidentally was cast back into 1846 and separated from the Enterprise, and he lands off the coast of England. Where the shuttlecraft thankfully disappears beneath the waters, and he tries to keep away, trying from human contact. He doesn't want to disturb, the prime directive at all. And he happens to meet up with a young Victorian adventuress who is a descendant of folks who had seen the first meteorite seen by human beings at Wald Newton in the area where Spock was. And it's her diary and her connection socially with people in Victorian London, including Lady Ada Augusta Lovelace. So it's an interesting story of how their relationship develops. They eventually get married and produce Mycroft and Sherlock before Spock is finally rescued by the Enterprise. But he has broken the Prime Directive so many times, he is going to be seen negatively by Starfleet. But he does happen to help the Enterprise destroy a meteorite that would have hit Earth in the future. So that kind of mitigates that a bit. And then the story continues with Holmes and how he tracks down Moriarty and what else Moriarty has stolen from Spock when he crashed, including a beacon that Spock made with help from Lady Ada Augusta Lovelace and her friends. So there's lots of fun stuff in there for Sherlockians.
Computer science people with Babbage and Lovelace. My husband, who's a software engineer, really appreciated and enjoyed that aspect of your story.
So that's basically the entire story, but it's I think it's a fun read. I now have over 300 downloads because I had to make it essentially free. I mean, I won't say just, but it is crossover fiction, and I wasn't about to pay Paramount Pictures $50,000 or whatever in order to be able to to use the character of Spock. I did make a couple of copies, which I passed out, to friends and to BSI members, privately printed. But it's a free download on Archive of Our Own. Just look for Spocklock and enjoy.
There's also Star Trek Easter eggs, not just Sherlockian Easter eggs.
Oh yes.
Oh totally. Oh, yeah.
So it really is a crossover piece of fiction where Sherlockians can enjoy it, Star Trek people can enjoy it, Trekkies can enjoy it, and maybe people who like Sherlock but not Star Trek might be like, I'm going to check out this Trek to the Stars. And people who like Star Trek but haven't read Sherlock Holmes, well, maybe I'll start reading some Sherlock. So it's really a great sort of
I even got a comment on Archive of Our Own. People can post comments, and that was essentially one of them. He said, this is great for even someone who is not a big Star Trek or Sherlock Holmes fan. It's generally accessible because people do have a general knowledge of Star Trek and Sherlock Holmes. And by the way, I do want to give a shout out. I can't say I did this alone. I was ably helped by a young woman who Lucy Kiefer, who
she's lovely.
I actually employed to do some research for me and to help me with my awkward way of writing and whatnot. And a good friend, Don McCann, who I've known for over 50 years. Who is a computer programmer and also I think he and I went to the very first Star Trek movie together. I remember standing outside in the cold in Regina, Saskatchewan, waiting to get in to see the original Star Trek movie. So, we bounced around ideas and as Monica said, put in little things that, a diehard Trekkie or a diehard, Sherlockian would catch. That maybe a general reader wouldn't, but it all makes sense.
Oh, it totally does. And like one of the things that I had totally forgotten is that Ponfar is on a 7-year cycle, and it is canonical that there is a 7-year gap between Mycroft and Holmes. And so it's like the perfect explanation.
Yeah. When I was there at that con, the 221 BCon, a young woman came up. This woman was fantastic. Her screen name was Abundantly Queer, I think. And she had given a brilliant talk on what the British Army was like, back around the time of Holmes. But in any event, she says to me, because at this point it was just talking about Sherlock as being, Spock's son. And she said, yeah, but what about Mycroft? And that's exactly how I answered her. I said, how much older than Sherlock is Mycroft? 7 years. What is the Pon-Farr cycle? She goes, oh my God, of course, it must be true.
Monica, you've been a Star Trek fan do you watch the original series? I'm assuming you're
okay. So I mean, like my Star Trek history, I mean, I grew up watching TNG because, you know, I'm of the appropriate age-ish to be having watched TNG as it aired. But you also have to remember, in 87 I was a wee lass of six. And so you also have to remember, I'm lucky to have had nerdy parents who made me watch, who were acquiesced my requests. I started with TNG, Deep Space Nine. I'm not going to lie, Deep Space Nine has basically become kind of like my comfort food. So whenever my husband and I are both sick or one of us is sick, you can always hear like the Deep Space Nine theme song playing somewhere in the house, because that's like, that's comfort food, which sounds really awful when I say it out loud.
I get it.
But it's an exceedingly well-crafted show. Then I did Voyager, and then I basically went back and did TOS. And I really, really liked TOS, but I also was a video store clerk in the 90s, and then therefore grew up with watching the movies and trying to justify my awful, awful, terrible pay by getting all the free rentals I could possibly muster. And so I made it through all of the Star Trek movies. But I have to admit, it's kind of like my Sherlockian interests predated slightly my Star Trek interest, but Star Trek's always been part of my life. Sherlock Holmes has always been part of my life, but it wasn't until kind of like my late teens when I then watched Star Trek VI. And then like, I remember like watching the VHS and putting it on pause and yelling, "Mom, Mom, you can't believe Spock is the ancestor, Sherlock Holmes is Spock's ancestor. What the heck?" I mean, it just, in very teenage nerdy exuberance. Yeah. I mean, and it was years later, of course, that I finally met Nick and, realized, oh my gosh, like the 7% solution, which I didn't even like read until I was in my mid 20s. That amazing book was written by the same guy who wrote that line in Star Trek VI. Yeah. And what's fascinating to me, knowing a lot more about Nick's career and knowing about kind of his involvement with Sherlockiana and Star Trek and whatnot, it's fascinating to me to kind of note that even though Nick hasn't always written a lot of Sherlock Holmes books or hasn't always been massively involved, he comes back to it. Mm-hmm. So even though he is, like one of the Star Trek gods, if you will, like, in the pantheon of gods, one of his great love is Sherlock Holmes. I mean, it started his career, that when there have been times when there have been lulls in his career, he's come back to write some of the books. And I mean, when you think about it, there was 7% in 74, then there was the West End Horror in 76. Yeah. And then it wasn't until 91 until he did the Canary Trainer. Mm-hmm. And then since 2019 he's done two, soon to be three, books, and he's going to have another one on the way, because he's got a two-book deal with Otto Penzler at the Mysterious Bookshop. The 2019 one, Peculiar Protocols, is really good, and I think it's actually the closest one that that kind of hits with 7%. 7% is a massive social commentary on drug culture and whatnot, whereas the Peculiar Protocols, which was his fourth Sherlock Holmes book, the one that was released in 2019, is actually a social commentary on basically fake news and misinformation.
My introduction to Star Trek included watching the original series when I was a freshman in college. And in our dorm, the dorm general TV set had been stolen. And, we were up in arms because we couldn't watch Star Trek. And finally, the dean of students took some money out of some fund and bought us another TV set so we could watch Star Trek. And we did. But my real introduction to the fan part of the Star Trek universe was in approximately 1979, 1980, maybe 81. I was actually in San Francisco for a completely different conference. I was a big microcomputer person at the time. Built my first computer from a kit around 79, 32K of memory, 2 megahertz processor, which I overclocked to 2.5 megs.
Yes.
But I was at the West Coast Computer Fair, and I was wandering around the area in San Francisco, and at a hotel, it said Star Trek Convention. I said, oh, I didn't know there were Star Trek conventions. And so I walked in, and I see all these people wearing Spock ears and pawing through photographs and outtakes, of the original series. And they were showing outtakes of the video where the turbo lift door didn't open in time and Captain Kirk walks right into it. And, some of those things and, selling photos and whatnot. And I just didn't know there was such a thing as a Star Trek convention. And actually, my second convention that I ever went to was that one in 2015.
And actually, I realized
it was 2 years in between.
It was 2014, Bob. I found the photo of us from January 12th of 2015, but baby me, baby you.
Yeah,
so
that's right.
Yeah, okay. January 12th of 2015. So this is a decade long project. Wow. Yeah, decade long project that you've been working on.
Wow.
It took a long time to pry readable text out of me without the help of my friends. I'm not sure it would be here, but my mission has been accomplished. I wanted to read this story. And now I have many times I have read this story. So I've been happy with that. And if it brings, some joy to people to read it as well, that's great. Certainly, it's worth what you pay for it by definition.
Oh, it's worth a lot more than that.
It was also a chance for me to poke some gentle fun. I mean, as I say in the beginning, people have written Sherlock Holmes pastiches, and they've been true to the character and the time, and they've included such absurdities as dinosaurs in Victorian London. It's been all over the place. But I start off with a quote by Bertrand Russell saying, whenever you look at any subject, any philosophy, only stick with what is true. You must base your opinions on facts, and only facts. And of course, that's tongue in cheek because obviously we're dealing with two fictional universes. But
Are we really?
Well, in the multiverse, this has happened. Okay.
There we go. Yeah.
This one.
Like, you're not supposed to use the F word. That's not appropriate, Bob.
Anyway, I make sure that everything that is quoted, in the story is based on fact. The fact that Lady Lovelace's husband was an engineer, and he was fascinated with tunnels. So there is, a reference to his building tunnels on their estate. There is an inventor who, before, Goodyear in the United States came up with his recipe for rubber was usable, was patented in England.
Mm-hmm.
And of course, there's a scene in there where he's trying. He originally called it pickling. He used a pickling process to create this type of rubber that was more useful. Mm-hmm. And of course, he's trying to think of a better name for that. And what comes up? But something based on maybe vulcanization. That would be a good term. And Spock, of course, hearing this, oh God, no, don't use that.
No, no.
Violating the prime directive enough. Don't make it so obvious. I'm even considering, you know, there, Sherlockians know, you know, there are two volumes, separate volumes of the annotated Sherlock Holmes, which are wonderful because when you first read a story and it talks about, you know, the gasogene and the tantalus, you say, what the heck is the gasogene? What's a tantalus? And of course, having an annotated edition with the definitions on either side, I thought maybe just for my own, you know, enjoyment, to go back and create an annotated version of my story, because I'd like to point out all these little things that maybe that even dedicated lovely. Sherlockians haven't caught all of them. I don't know.
Leonard Nimoy, who played Spock, as I'm sure everybody knows, also has a couple of other Sherlockian connections. Now, William Gillette is widely known as the person who wrote the first really good Sherlock Holmes play and played Sherlock Holmes. Nimoy played Holmes in that play, not when it was first written. That was at the turn of the 19th century or 20th century. But he was in it in 1976. There, to my knowledge, there's no video of it. But did you guys have a chance to view the video? He played Sherlock Holmes about a year before that in something called The Interior Motive.
My secrets within you must seek out. But spare my skin or break my heart. No signature on the note, and no one saw it arrive. Yet it wasn't there when I went for breakfast at 8:06, and Scroggins, the newsboy, would have seen it arrive after 8:15. Most intriguing.
Now, this was part of a series called The Universe and I on PBS, and it was really made for Kansas City schools, or Kansas schools, I think. And they were exploring how to tell the makeup of a planet without going inside the planet, just by some sort of deducing things and inferring things from the exterior of the planet. And it's set up as Nimoy is Sherlock Holmes, and Bert something was played Watson, somebody I've never heard of. What did you guys think of this? I'd heard of it, but I'd never seen it before.
I just watched it last night, in preparation for this, and that was interesting. I mean,
yeah, anytime somebody says, yeah, that was interesting, you know, there's more to it than that.
Yeah, so there's, well, it's the Midwestern in me. I mean, you know, if I was Minnesotan, I'd be like, oh, that's different.
Yes, you know, you could see they were using Sherlock Holmes and his powers of deduction, you know, to make a point, what they were teaching about the universe, or about Earth, as it turns out. But, you know, I would say, you know, to Nimoy at that point, I've known Sherlock Holmes and you're no Sherlock Holmes. Yeah. He did a tolerably good job.
It was okay,
but he was no Basil Rathbone, no Jeremy Brett,
But I mean, you know, I think it's less, I think, about his performance, because from what I've heard from Sherlockian friends who did see Nimoy in you know, his or treading the boards, if you will, you know, he was decent in that, like genuinely decent portrayal of Sherlock Holmes. And so I'm guessing that this was more of a less of a failure of him as an actor and more of a failure of the material that he was given.
The writing, I have to say, he three times, and then it stopped, but three times he referred to Watson as old
fish.
Old fish was one. My favorite was old puff. And then there was one other one that I can't recall. You know, it was like they were writing what they think Sherlock Holmes should sound like, but they'd never actually read a Sherlock Holmes story.
Exactly.
Yeah.
So, and his accent, I mean, occasionally it sounded like he was trying an English accent, but it was very, very loose. He said He had said, you know, during his career, that early in his career, he swore he'd take any job that was offered to him because he needed to feed his family. But I'm paraphrasing, but that was basically the quote. I suspect this was one of those jobs.
I mean, dude's got a mortgage, you know, family's right, got exactly. A kid, so I respect it. I mean, you know, I mean, we have a phrase in my family is I'm not too sexy for that job. you know, and I mean, there have been times in my life where it's like, you know, I have done jobs. Like I have massive respect for the janitorial arts and custodial arts because I spent an entire summer scrubbing toilets at a Catholic basilica in Wisconsin. And so I'm not too sexy for that job. And apparently neither was Leonard Nimoy.
Great. I have a toilet. You want to come up and... He also, after he was on stage as Holmes, he also did... he was involved in a series called In Search Of, which did usually, this was a very strange thing I found too. I mean, I've known about this for a long time. I had never watched it till this week, but they usually did like supernatural things or like Amelia Earhart's disappearance, things like that. And in this, they clearly wanted to do a thing about Sherlock Holmes, but they had to couch it in a mystery. So they were like, was Sherlock Holmes real? And then sort of quickly answered the question at the end. What did you guys think of? Did you guys have a chance to watch this one?
Yeah, well, first of all, the idea that Sherlock Holmes is real, they didn't come up with that. I mean, for many years, the Abbey National Building Society owned the property at approximately 221 Baker Street. Mm-hmm. And they employed, I believe it was a part-time, maybe a half-time secretary to answer letters to Sherlock Holmes that came to Sherlock Holmes, 221B Baker Street.
Mm-hmm.
And there was even a book published of some of the letters that were sent to. People were looking to Sherlock Holmes to find their lost dog, to help them solve a local mystery. But they wrote to him for many, many years. Maybe they still do. I don't know if that has continued. No. But I wrote to Sherlock Holmes or at the Abbey National Building Society when I became involved. At the time, it was the Jeremy Brett series and Vincent Price was hosting. And at the intro, he mentioned that the Abbey National Building Society had just demolished and were rebuilding that area and that you could get a brick, you know, for a donation to whatever it was at the time. And I was building a house with a fireplace and I wanted a brick. So I wrote them. Bricks were all gone, unfortunately. But there were many people who still think, well, you know, the conceit in among Sherlockians certainly is that it was Watson who wrote the stories and Conan Doyle was merely the literary agent who arranged for the stories to be published.
So, oh, yeah, we play the game, as we call it.
Play the game for the game's own sake. But exactly. Yes, you know, so they were quite correct in saying, yes, you know, is there a real Sherlock Holmes?
Or is Sherlock Holmes fictional or real? The answer is yes.
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 Very famously, yes.
Yeah, I mean, you know.
They came up with, they looked into the Adalji case, which is an actual case. Conan Doyle investigated and got the victim off, although he didn't get any restitution. But so they looked into that, and the episode basically at the end says, we maintain that there was a Sherlock Holmes in the form of Arthur Conan Doyle, was actually his own creation. So, you know, and I guess there's some, you know, some legitimacy to that. There was Dr. Bell was a real Sherlock Holmes in a way. He was the person that Holmes was created in homage to or fashioned after.
Right. I mean, you know, when a medical doctor, you know, is trying to solve the mystery of what is troubling this person, in order to come up with a diagnosis, they, you know, look for data and they try to make deductions so that they can discover, you know, the mystery, the what is troubling this person. So there's a lot of similarities. There was even a book, I think it was called The Medical Casebook of Sherlock Holmes.
Mm-hmm.
So the processes are very similar, if yeah. not identical in some sense.
Well, yeah, I mean, and I have to admit my little corner of the Sherlockian game, if you will, is I do DSM-5 diagnostic analyses of Sherlock Holmes or the various characters or facets of Sherlock Holmes, looking at modern diagnostics for mental health and the characters. So, I mean, you know, basically using those same, processes as Holmes.
Yeah.
So diagnostics, medical, mental health, it all basically matches.